Welcome to the Changing Face of Distribution panel. I'm Jude, Goldrei, and I will be chairing the panel today. And we are going to talk about the challenges of securing sales and distribution and of identifying and reaching audiences. We've got three brilliant guests today. We've got Christine Hartland, who has produced and exec produced several feature films. And is Containment your latest feature? So she's recently produced Containment, which was it released in the UK last year?
In autumn last year.
And the US, yes. And it's available online.
Yeah.
And is it having a DVD?
DVD in June.
In June.
So it's delayed.
Cool. Brilliant. And this is Nathan Wiseman, who is an actor, writer, and filmmaker, and starred in
too many things.
And he starred in gangster comedy Hackney's Finest, and his latest film that we're talking about today is called Hard Tide, which he co-directed, wrote, produced, and starred in.
Yeah, that sounds a lot.
Built
the cameras as well.
It's released, is it this month?
It's released, it's really had its theatrical release, and now it's on DVD and Sky and movies and all those kind of places. DVD market.
Fantastic. And this is Steve Oram, who is an actor and filmmaker with a background in live comedy. And he co-wrote and co-starred in Ben Wheatley's Sightseers alongside Alice Lowe. You're going to have to tell us how to pronounce.
You can pronounce it however you
want. How do you say it?
Depends on my mood. I don't know, it's up to you.
We'll just go with
I like it.
A bit flat.
Yeah.
Which is Steve's directorial debut. Cool. Okay, so the format for the panel is that we're going to show a trailer of each film, and then after each trailer, we'll ask the filmmaker to just give a bit of background to the film and also some kind of headline points about their distribution journey. So we'll go through each one, and then we'll open up the discussion with some questions about distribution. And then I will open it up to questions in the last 20 to 30 minutes. So do have a think about anything that you're dying to ask. And please, if you do ask a question, keep it really specifically to distribution. That would be great. Okay, so if we start with Christine's film, Containment. We've got a trailer. Christine, could you tell us just a brief background about how the film came about?
So I met Neil, the director, in 2009, and at that time I just finished producing my very first feature. And I decided that I needed to kind of share what I'd learned. And so I kind of said to Neil, I'll help you out, but I won't be able to produce it hands-on, and we'll find some other producer who does all the kind of daily and all the work on site. But so we had an investor at the time as well, so we had a bit of development money, which was great. And then it took up until 2014 before we actually had raised the money. And then we had also on board two producers, Casey Herbert and Peter Smythe, ex-NFTS or NFTS graduates. So they were actually the ones who were on site, you know, on locations, and they were driving the project. And I was kind of I found the money. So I was actually liaising with the exec producer and also looking at the sales and distribution and seeing where the film could be going to have a kind of a life afterwards. Because that's the key thing, is you don't want to spend all that time, all that energy, and then you've got an amazing, you know, film that you kind of go, brilliant, and now who's going to watch it? No one, you know, friends and family, and won't even be all your friends actually, because when you realise when it's out there, half your friends are too busy, or, you know, so it's very difficult. It needs to break outside. So We tried to do the sales, just, you know, having the sales agent, but as a debut feature, you didn't get that, so you have to do it first.
Cool. So you did, and was the was it all kind of private finance?
Yeah,
as opposed to
just one investor.
One investor.
Yeah.
Okay. And is it possible? Do you just to say a ballpark budget?
It's a low budget, low basically. Budget. Yeah.
Yeah.
We're not supposed to disclose exact figures. But yeah, it's a very tiny budget. Most of it is on the screen because it has to be, but everyone is paid.
Yeah, cool. And so you were looking at kind of trying to secure some deals after you shot the film. It's very hard because it's a first feature. So at what stage do you think any sort of significant deals or distribution arrangements were made?
So. We did, because of Casey and Pete's NFTS background, which was really useful, we had the opportunity to show a trailer before we finished the film at BAFTA. It was like a showcase. So we had a trailer way before we kind of locked pictures. And so that enabled us to kind of send to potential sales agent and distributors. So we had some interest. Kind of in the autumn of 2014, and then we'd arranged to go to AFM in LA, the film market, which is quite daunting because you feel very, very tiny. And we managed to secure a few meetings, and then we did the same in Berlin. So we kind of basically, you do all the markets, you just have to, I mean, that's my only way. My background is not film, it's corporate, so I don't have a film connections, I had to build them, and the best ways to attend markets, and we just stalk nicely people and just keep them posted with every, you know, updates. So so that's kind of basically what we did, and then we had some interest, and as soon as we had a film good enough to show, we kind of sent trailer, copy of film unfinished still.
Yeah.
But we really finished.
To some of the sorts of the people you already met at AFM.
Yeah.
And
I mean, we did some calling obviously as well.
Yeah. Was it useful to go to both of those markets?
Yes, it's key. I mean,
to go.
I wouldn't be able to sell or push a film without going to those markets. So there's Berlin is probably the most. I mean, Cannes is fun, and it's, everyone attends it, more or less, but it's very big, and people are very busy when you're an independent film producer. However, Berlin is smaller, and so you get to meet more people, and it's in February in the winter, so there's not that many people you'll be faffing about, you know, so you get kind of faster, and it's cheaper. Goldrei I've been as well, which is really nice. And AFM, basically my aim was to try and get a US sales agent purely because then they would have an in the US, because otherwise the UK market, you end up that you kind of know it a little bit, and it was, you know, to crack, I mean crack, it's a big word, isn't it, but to be in the US, I think a US sales agent is probably easier than having a UK sales agent. So that was the aim. As it happened, we were lucky and we did get a US sales agent. AFM is how you meet them, or CAF.
Yeah, fantastic. Now, what ways have audiences been able to access your film, which you've kind of explained a bit before?
So basically, the lesson from my very first feature, WMD, was that, you know, all the money, all the effort goes into making the film, and then you've got this kind of master, you know, tape, it was back then, or file, and then you realise that no one is actually going to see it unless you put money behind the PR and marketing. So that was my key lesson, is on every budget, you need to keep behind some money, and I'm not talking £200, I'm talking a bigger chunk, so you can actually use it and get PR and marketing. And it needs to be more than, you know, social media and Facebook ads. It needs to be proper PR with kind of things that I can't do, and that most of us, I suspect, unless you have a background in PR, wouldn't do, because you don't have those relationships. It just helps lift the film just above everyone else's. There's kind of, the market's saturated with content, so it's how do you cut through that noise? And I think it's the same, sales agent distributors then kind of will pay attention to those films, ironically. So my key thing on Containment and all the other films is to make sure that part of the budget is kind of ring-fenced for marketing.
Which you say you put that in your kind of production budget from the start, and including actually attending the market and things like that.
And there's also schemes which we applied, but we were too far down the line, like finding your audience with Film London. And then, so we didn't get on this, building your audience. We didn't get on this, but a year later, we got a call from someone who was on the panel, and it was Wheel Colony, which I don't know if you've heard of it, but the thing that was interesting is they have so they want films with cast, known cast. We had Louise Brealey, so that kind of ticked that box. But what they do, which I really liked, is all your behind the scene that you do, unless, you know, if you're 100% sure you're going to get a DVD release, which you don't know often, you kind of go, oh, you've wasted all that time. You know, it might be on your website, but no one is ever going to see it. And Work Colony has all of that, so it's kind of the behind the scenes that you used to have on DVDs, which is online, which is actually really like.
Yeah, brilliant.
So, and they kind of push and they do really nice advertising. So it was trying to find partners so you just increase your exposure in whichever way.
Yeah, fantastic. And did you have, I can't remember if you said, did you have any kind of theatrical release?
Yes, so we did have a limited theatrical release, I would call it. And we did that ourselves, because if you go distribution companies and sales agent companies are not really that interested unless they see a potential in terms of recouping, etc. So we did it ourselves, and the reason why we did this is if you do, I believe it's a minimum of 6 screens, then you get onto higher online platforms. So you get to Sky Store, you get on Google Play, AOL, all of those, Virgin Media. So you basically reach higher online platforms. And we thought that was key. So we kind of, basically, you don't recoup on a theatrical release, but it gets you that exposure, and it also gives you a more sort of critics.
And you qualify for BAFTA as well.
And you qualify for BAFTA, yes. Yes, indeed. That's true. That was in all my, on my plan, actually, for some reason, but yes.
Brilliant. Thank you, Christine. I actually forgot to ask. I just wanted to get a sense of who's in the audience. How many of you are producers? Quite a lot of producers. Any directors? Any writers? Oh, okay. Brilliant. And how many of you have made a feature film? Quite a few. And how many are currently trying to make their first feature? Okay, cool. So this is, that's great. It's going to be really useful hearing about your experience. Okay, so let's go on to the next trailer, which is Nathaniel Wiseman's Hard Tide. Looks great. So Nathaniel, could you please tell us a bit of brief background into how the film came about?
Sure. So I came off just being an actor for another film, and then looking at all these sort of gangster type films, which is a bit sort of sad. I think the market's quite saturated with that kind of, you know, geezers doing all that stuff. And I did a short film with a director who was just graduated from the London Film School, and we met from school. We started talking, went down to Margate, which I went to as a kid and stuff, and I had a really amazing experience working with this, doing this film in Margate for sort of 4 days, and then came back and I run a production company called Redeeming Features, and we were supposed to go on a bigger film, and we lost the availability of an actor, so then we sort of put that on hold, and I got really just kept thinking, there's something about this little story in Margate, and it could be turned into a bigger feature film. It was only, I think, 5 minutes long, short. So then I approached the director and said, look, why don't we just see what money we can grab together, go off, make this film, and just see what happens. Let's just go for it, really. And then the snowball started gathering, and it became a monster that we couldn't kill, basically. We just, we were, before we know it, we were there, and we shot the film, I think, in 28 days. We raised, not a lot of money, but in about a month, we raised a fair chunk of change, you'd say. We are a micro budget. And then we edited the film. It's based on a true story. And what I really wanted to do is disguise a sort of a drama inside that kind of gangster genre, because that's what the marketplace likes. I mean, the film was originally called My Hero, and then our sales agent and distributor changed the name to Hard Time, with our consent, because they wanted to sort of hit that demographic. But before we got the sales agent and the distribution, for another film I'm doing, we got an American sales agent attached called Aldemisa, who are far too big for us. They did Chef and Sin City 2 and these kind of films, and they took, I managed to blag an MG off them to take the world rights for the film, barring the UK, knowing that this film really, honestly, will not break out of the UK. It's a very British story. It's a crime thriller. It is based on a true story, and these stories do happen all over the world, but it's very British. So I held back the UK, then we started submitting the film to festivals. The first festival we went to was Raindance. They selected it, and they championed the film. They really liked us, they liked the ethos of how we made it. I don't come from sort of an industry background, I don't come from money or anything like that. We just went off and trying to tell a story that we believed in and make a film that we're proud of, really. The film got selected for that, and then on the back of that, a company called Metrodome in the UK picked us up for distribution. And then we've just had our limited theatrical release, and now we're on Sky Store, or Sky Movies, Amazon Prime, Netflix, all over the place. So please buy the DVD. It's in HMV as well, and all those usual places where you buy the DVD. Yeah.
Fantastic.
So that's it.
So with the sales agent, at what point did they come on board? What did they need to see before they came on board?
Similar to Christine, I was cutting bits of the film together to show people sizzles of what we were doing to sort of try and create interest. But Metrodome only really came on board after Raindance. Yeah, they came to our premiere of Raindance, and we sort of threw a bit of a party. They liked the film, and then we just handed them until they took it. Well, they came to us, yeah. But I, for the future, all the films that we're doing, we are attaching a sales agent from the get-go, because I think, as we were all sort of saying, you just don't want to make the most expensive home movie ever made. You know, you want it to find its audience. And I think having a business strategy built in at the get-go is saying, okay, here's where the audience is for this and how to reach them. It's invaluable, yeah. You need to, you know, finding the right sales agent is another challenge in itself. Yeah,
brilliant. Well, fantastic to have Lynch Day on board as well.
Yeah.
Cool. And did you say that there was a theatrical?
Yeah, it was a very limited theatrical release. And I think we opened the same day as Captain America, so it was ridiculous. Yeah. We were like competing against Disney. And we did Q&As up and down the country along the coast. The film was shot exclusively in Margate and Ramsgate area. So we did a lot of screenings there. I went to schools and did talks about making your first film. Not that I'm not qualified, but just like, you know, and trying to like go, you know, it's a tough time for independent filmmaking, but, you know, there's other voices that matter that aren't just, you know, the other side, the Hollywood industry. So, And then we toured it around, and we did Q&As and we did screenings up and down wherever would host us really. And then to build in as a bit of a marketing flow as well into the digital platform and the DVD release system. Yeah.
Fantastic. Oh, great. Thanks, Nathaniel. So, yes, if we move on to the next trailer, which is Steve Oram's thanks for that, Steve. Lovely clip he chose for us.
Light-hearted rom-com.
Also, gives a bit of an indication about how to pronounce the film title.
Yeah.
I love the trailer, it's all the music. It's really
yeah, that's
good.
King Crimson on that.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Cool. So would you be able to tell us a bit about how your film came about?
Yeah, so this, well, the idea, again, like the other two, was through a business. We had a business plan right from the start, and that was to make a film that was really low budget, involving many of my mates who are from the comedy world, and do it as simply and as quickly as possible, and cut out and try and hold on to any cash we might make. So that was the plan, and so we started. I'd sort of had three scripts, I think, and this one was the cheapest to make because it involved so little money to make. It's, you think of the less amount of money, the least amount of money you can make a film for, this is what we made it for. So this was set all in very simple locations involving cast or cast for free, a lot of people for free. I raised this money all myself, and it's my own money, which came from a voiceover I did, because I'm an actor and do a lot of voiceovers for commercial radio and things like that. And I did one voiceover that landed from the heavens, gave me the entire budget, and so that allowed the film to happen. But by doing this, we weren't getting money from anywhere else. We had no one influencing us. We had no one wanting their money back. So it was all, you know, it was all very simple. So, you know, it was difficult for me because that's my money, and I knew I was going to throw it away. I wrote it off, you know, and this is what I'm doing for this film. It's a one-off. So we had this money, and we made it. We shot it in kind of one flat, really, in various locations over 2 weeks. And the big thing for us was to get really good cast involved. So that we'd have a chance of selling it and making our money back. Because all I wanted to do is make money back. So I asked a lot of my friends, people like Julian Barrett, Noel Fielding's in it, Toya Wilcox, who I didn't know, but I just sent her the script, and she really loved it. She has to do some incredibly embarrassing things in it as well. She has to have sex on a washing machine and things like that. She was up for it. Because that was the idea behind it, you know. I think this industry is driven a lot by your cast and people. You know, people want to go and see some people they know. So largely a comedy cast. So we finished the film, and then this was part of our business plan. It sort of fit into the genre world because it's a very left field idea. This is the only way we could, you know. I didn't even bother asking for money. It's another reason why I didn't bother asking for money, because I wanted to do such a left field idea. I wanted to do something as mad and as weird as I wanted to, without anyone saying, "Oh, it's a bit much, mate." And this was the only way to have that freedom. If you have private finance and you're doing a really weird idea like that, I don't think anyone would give you. I did go to see one major production company to ask for money in the early days of funding, and they I won't say who it was. They're a really big company, like the biggest. And they told me it was the funniest script they'd ever read. And I went, "Oh yeah, okay, brilliant, let's go and make it then." And they said, "Oh no, we can't, because we're not going to do that, because we just made Les Mis." "Oh, you can work it out now, can't you?" Imagine that, Les Miserables. We very carefully thought about where we wanted to put this for its first festival, which was Fright Fest. I work with Andy Stark, who's a producer who works on Ben Wheatley's films, some of you I know from Sightseers, which was a film I did about 4 or 5 years ago now, which was high budget, but had that ethos of rough and ready about it. And so we knew the Fright Fest lot, so we put it into that genre crowd. We wanted it to be quite small, sold out kind of vibe. So we had this lovely night in the View, Leicester Square, and from that we had our press officer called Zoe Flower, who arranged for. We knew that we had no money to spend on publicity. All we had was a press agent who made sure all the press were there. This one big first screening, and from that we generated a lot of reviews, a lot of interest. The film did really, did. From there we springboarded onto lots of other festivals. It's still going, in fact, because it fits into that niche of people like to see weird stuff. Basically, people having sex and talking like monkeys. Through that we got hooked up with Icon, who have a DVD and VOD deal with the people that run Frightfest, called Frightfest Presents Icon. And we were put onto that label, and from there we got our VOD release and also DVD and Blu-ray. But independently of that, since it's generated, we've had just loads of amazing press. That's the thing, because it's such an out there weird idea. Everyone speaks like monkeys. There's no dialogue in it. No one's seen that before. And so it's had some great press, and through that we've a lot of word of mouth, and we had a very limited cinema release with Pitch House Cinemas. Again, we were doing similar to Nathaniel's groups with one-off dates where I was going around doing Q&As and things like that. But they were just one, rather than week runs, we were doing one-off dates here. We went all around the country, in Scotland and Northern Ireland and places like that, and built it from there. Then Icon came on board and gave us that VOD release. And then independent of that, we've since then sold it to Australia and France for the DVD and VOD over there. So it's done good, It's punched. We came at it from a position of nothing to lose, because we haven't spent any money on it, and anything you get is a bonus almost. And it's done better than it's punched above its weight. That's what I was looking for.
That's a really great outcome, really, isn't it?
We knew what we were dealing with, and we knew that there was no point. We haven't had a sales agent, we haven't played any of that game, because as soon as you do that, you start giving away your money. And I needed to get my money back so I could pay people who I hadn't paid. I paid the skit people on the film, but I didn't pay the rich actors, and some of them aren't that rich, but I didn't pay the actors, and I didn't pay the various of the crew, but I would love to just get some money back and then be able to give them a cheque, I still haven't made any money. Absolutely. So it's kind of from the point of view, this is a one-off, we're doing this as a one-off, we'll ask favours, we'll do it, and we'll do it for, we'll do it with the best cast we can, and I think that's through this combination of things, we've managed to make it work.
And so with Ben Wheatley and Andy Stark, were they just straight away on board because you'd already had a really good relationship with them?
Ben wasn't really involved. Ben was, it was because Rook Films released it, so it's through his company.
Yes.
But Andy produced it, did all the day-to-day producing, and it was there right from the start.
It was just put
his
company.
They put his, that's right, and Ben's, famous man.
Yeah,
but Rook Films, rather than they're releasing it, so it's their the deal we had with Icon. You don't really get paid money to have your film distributed now. You get a cut, So that's the world we live in. So it's really, really hard to make any money. So we're playing a long game with this a little bit. So it's hopefully to c- cult film, everyone says it. But it's hopefully going to stick around, and maybe the £10 will mount up. In 20 years, I might be able to afford a new set of garden furniture. Something like that. I haven't even got a garden.
It sounds like one of the reasons that was a good thing is it's had quite a good brand, which
it
ties in quite well with the sights here, sort of dark comedy brand really well.
So I'm in a slightly different position really, because it's trading on reputations really. So I was in a very fortunate position to be able to do it. Great people to be attached to.
And then, so when it showed at Fright Fest, did, and I guess also Rook Films has a good relationship with Fright Fest, which helps, and then did Icon come to you, they sort of picked things up there and
they did. Well, we had offers from a couple of other people as well, but we chose them because it was all tied in, and their label was really good for Fright Fest presenters, and it just seemed to fit right for us. And they did a great job with DVD and Blu-ray. They fronted all the costs for that. And it worked out fine, really. And similar with the release, our thing was never to push it, never to ask and to keep everyone at arm's length. Because throughout the whole process of this, I'd have people asking me, what's going on with your film, Because the new is quite an interesting idea, and people knew about the cast involved in it. Toy Wilcox, Julian Barrett and Noel Fielding gets his penis bitten off and stuff like that. It actually happens. And so it's like getting this sort of very, we were very careful to just keep to play it cool, and that really worked for us. But that's just the circumstances we were in. And the same with the Picture House Cinemas, we negotiated that deal with them directly. We just went in and we hadn't even seen the film. We said who was in it and who was involved. And he said, okay, yeah, cool, you can do every Friday night for 6 weeks in Pitch House Central. So that's what we did. And then we did the same thing all around, with the different pitch houses. So it worked great. Lots of independence and lots of fun.
That's brilliant.
Totally cut everyone out. Really hard work though. It's 2 years of. This is from 2014. We filmed it in the summer, 2 years ago now. We had it completed by January. Everything pitch locked, grade, everything done. And then we had it. The release was last summer, so a year ago. That's the trajectory. A year and a half. It was all done really, that's what we wanted to do. Sightseers took 6 years to make. You can't. That's a lot of life gone, isn't it?
Trying to raise the money and then make it.
Yeah.
And then the distribution, you've got a whole another journey ahead
you
of
do,
you.
You do, yeah.
It goes on. And,
you do.
Thanks, Steve. And thanks to all of you for sharing your stories. Really, really interesting. I was wondering it sounds like Fright Fest was a really good platform to launch the film, and often festivals are.
Yeah.
And Christine and Nathaniel, how useful were festivals?
Raindogs was really helpful.
You
need more festivals like that support independent films, really. It just gives you that platform to, as you said, just to get it out.
It's quite tough if you're not a genre.
Yeah.
If you're not in a genre. Mm-hmm. Area, then it's very hard, isn't it? I have a friend who's got a thriller at the moment. It's a brilliant film. It's called The Goldrei, but it's finding it quite tricky to find anywhere to place it.
Mm.
So that's the world, that is the world, really.
Mm. Yeah, we did. Our policy wasn't actually to aim for festivals. You want to, and that is always kind of the aim generally, but we quickly realised it was kind of more. It is a thriller, and it was more commercial, and we wanted it to be out as soon as possible. So suddenly, between the time we finished, which was kind of March, April, and we knew we were going to release in August, that doesn't give you a big festival window. So we launched at the East End Film Festival, which I love, and that was kind of the platform. And then we sent it to others, you know, kind of US and Europe. But it's not a festival film. You know, if you want to be really honest, it's not a festival film. It's great to have the laurels and have that recognition. But also, you don't want it to do lots of festivals because you don't really get any money. So you want to commercialise it and get the money in as soon as you can. So there's that kind of balance as well to sort of strike.
Yeah, absolutely. So going back, you've all talked a bit about it, but in terms of when you were trying to either raise the money for the film or get people on board, or find partners and distribution partners, what sort of, when you were pitching your films and having to call it a genre, what sort of challenges did you come up against? And also, did you sometimes pitch it in a certain way and people would tell you that, you know, that's not what it is, or, you know, did you get told that you're wrong? And, Christine, yeah,
I've just got told that in Cannes about another project. Don't pitch it that way. Alright. How do I pitch it?
Don't say the word drama, we got a lot, you know.
Or coming of age, or whatever it is, yeah. But Containment, I always pitch it as a thriller. Ironically, you'll find it as a horror. Which I find
is
a tiny bit upsetting because we all come with expectations. So if you're a horror fan, which I'm not, and I can't cope with horror, you know, if you are a horror fan, a true horror fan, and you watch Containment, you'd be, I think, a bit upset, and, you know, expectation would then sort of, you know, they're not met, and that then kind of triggers bad comments, and then, you know, it goes online, and so on. So I don't quite understand that logic from the sales and distributor point of view, but you know they keep saying or they keep telling us that we have to be put in a little box. But that I'm struggling with.
Yeah, we were told, because essentially we tried to hide a drama inside a thriller crime genre. So we were really sort of Trojan horse in the ship, just as like, okay, how do we do this? And they would say, yeah, you've got to say it's a thriller, you've got to say it's crime, actually we need to put more of the gangster stuff on it. To be fair, a lot of states don't really like gangster, but there's not that much gangster stuff in it. It's about a relationship between a small-time criminal and a nine-year-old girl who went on the run together. But we had to sort of throw in this crime stuff. And even the way it's packaged now, and the change of the title, it's completely to get to that market. And that's just, you know, unfortunately the way it is. To pigeonhole stuff.
Yeah. So did it actually affect the script a little bit?
Affect the script actually when you made the film.
Because you made at that point made it, so you didn't. Yeah. It's funny because I think obviously when people are trying to raise development money or have partners on board early on, then the pitching is just constantly changing because at that stage you can get told that you shouldn't call it a thriller because it's actually a drama. But then later on everyone's calling it thriller to market it, so it's negotiating that.
The negotiation. I mean, it's a constant evolving thing, isn't it?
I did, and
it was the mental brand. I don't know, sort of. It is to an extent this crowbarred into a horror genre. It's a deeply dark, disturbing, dystopian comedy, I think. But I personally quite liked the genre a lot because it gives you, those festivals have given us a good publicist. They're very open and willing bunch of people. And that's kind of different, you know. We just did it all ourselves in our own free way.
Yeah. Did you cut the trailer yourself, or was that
No, Andy cut the trailer actually. I cut the film myself. Yeah, did everything. Really.
How long was the shoot?
It was a 2-week shoot.
Wow.
Yeah. But it was just so well planned, you know. It was nothing left to chance.
Precision. Have it.
And what about marketing? What stage did you start thinking about marketing? And did you take any early steps in the marketing of film, as in sort of getting information out there, or did it come into the production at all? Were you shooting anything with that in mind for later in terms of how you'd market it, how you would find an audience?
I cut a little sort of sizzle of what we were doing, I think, week two, and mainly that was to show the crew that what they were doing was actually making something that wasn't just shit. and then we used that to raise some finance as well. We were just sort of like, here we go, we'll make this. But again, the teaser that we made was very, very different to the trailer that you've seen there. Completely different.
So you kind of started it sort of around production and in preparation.
Yeah, we started it marketing a little bit before, but because the problem you have is, you can put your Facebook page or whatever, and then it takes 5 years, so there's nothing much you can say in 5 years, and that's a problem about some of my features. So you've got a lovely Facebook page with, your friends feeling quite sorry for you, and they're kind of like, but you kind of hover that 200, 400 likes, and that's it. So it's not enough to kind of prove to anyone, actually, that you've got something good. But it's there. You kind of don't really want to delete it, because you're like, well, I might as well be there. And you never know, it might happen really quickly, and then it doesn't. But it is kind of quite key. I really believe in the social media. The power of social media is really, really key, especially for an independent filmmaker. And I have got twice money through social media, people I did not know. So it does kind of randomly work.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow. So, it's a bit random, I have to admit. But so I think certain things, you need to be out there. At the same time, I do realise that you can't, for Containment, the title changed 3 days before we were greenlit, before we were going to Berlin. It was called for 4.5 years, or however long it was, Alpha. And we kept Alpha. Luckily, we didn't do a Facebook page. We didn't do a Twitter or anything. And then suddenly, we kind of went, it means nothing, Alpha. No one actually will know what it is. They'll think it's a drama, which it wasn't. And that was a very bright idea to change it before we launched it. But yeah, so it is kind of, it is part of my thinking. It's kind of to try and get a brand. And if you've got a brand, that is just brilliant. And you know exactly where it fits. You can trade on it. But when you sort of, I don't really have a brand. I don't, it's kind of very difficult. But you need to kind of build one and make sure people kind of know what you're selling, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. We didn't do anything on the. We didn't have anything on the as the film was going on. But quite soon after it was finished, the shoot was finished. We released the poster, so we had this really amazing image, which I don't know if you have it, but it's a man in a monkey suit, it's that was released on social media and made a big impact at the time and got people talking about it. And there were various little, in the year, 8 or 9 months leading up to the release of the film, just very small things like that trailer got released a few months later, really quick, it's 20 seconds, I think. And I was cutting small things, like I was doing things like this quite a bit actually. At the time, and so I was cutting little things and showing them to people who were coming to these things, just like what I was working on, and that kind of works as well. Just in small ways, it's quite put the vibe out there. Yeah. It helps having something good, something interesting to talk about. I've done sightseers and I've done art, and they both had good hooks. They both kind of, as soon as you say it, people are really interested. And the people in the industry are really interested, the people at Studio Canal are just going, what are you doing, this is mental, it's mad, it's got all these amazing people. And it's worked so well, just having something no one else is doing it. You know, if you can think of something and you're of that bent as a person, it's great, you know.
So hook that stands out.
The person who's
interesting,
complete weirdo.
Yeah. And the imagery always helps really well.
Yeah.
And finally, before we go out to some questions, do you have any thoughts on whether you think it feels like it's a good time to be an independent filmmaker and what the market is like for low-budget films? And whether the sort of the changes in sort of opportunities for distribution, the way films are distributed, is that helping things? Is it creating more opportunities, or is it making it more difficult?
I think it's a tough time for independent films, but at the same time, you can go off and make something. You've got the technology and things like that. It's a lot cheaper than it's ever been, I think. And as you say, you can just go off and create something that you want to do. And there's, you know, you can raise finance through Kickstarter, which we did for a tiny piece of our budget. And you can just, it's difficult to get stuff into the marketplace, but at the same time, it's constantly evolving. People watch films on their phones and stuff, so you can, there's other platforms. You don't have to do the traditional distribution route. It depends what you're making the film for. If it's, and how much money is involved, and how much you want to get recouped and stuff. I don't want it to be doom and gloom where you're sitting going, we've come through the trenches, so we may be a bit jaded, but I think by and large
it's impossible to make money. I think that's the thing. And no one, if you are an independent filmmaker, you will not make money. Because you can't, it's a serious point, you can't compete with the advertising budgets of.
You can't, yeah.
There's no way. Those people have multi-million pound, the more mainstream films. Which is what the only thing anyone watches at the cinema they have huge, the advertising budget. I think there was a stage a few years ago where people doing lower budget films could get ahead of awards, but that's disappeared now. So even people with £1-2 million films can't get ahead of the awards. I've worked on a few, and it's
tough.
So I think it's kind of lowering your expectations really, and just.
Also, in this country, we kind of eat our young a little bit, where in France they have a quota of certain films to go in.
Yeah.
And this country, we don't know how many people went to go and see, sightseers in the movie, in the actual cinema, actually went to go and spend money in a theatrical environment, or did they watch it on DVD? Because more and more you're going to see these kind of Captain America, these crazy big old films, but you're not really going to watch like The Goob or a good film for indie, you know what I mean? And that's the problem, really. So I don't know. I mean, there's all this talk about, should we? I don't think you maybe want to compete with those kind of big films. You want to do stuff that's know your audience, know your niche.
It's the new B movie, So yeah. If you want to work in mainstream films and make money, then you've got to really change your product and your outlook and play a different game entirely. If you want to work in independent film, then that is an interesting place. There's loads of amazing stuff being made,
yeah.
But no one's getting any money. The key thing, I think, is paying your technicians and your actors, because that's really. I've done this film. I didn't pay half the people. I feel awful about that, and I can't. I hate it, and I can't do that again. Well, I might do in 10 years, but I haven't yet. Spend nothing basically, so that's the stage you're at, it's cutting everything down and down and down, which is really tough, but you can make interesting stuff as long as you're not going to make money. You have free, you have the freedom, and that's brilliant. It's better than ever, like, in that way, but you've got to,
I suppose it's also, for many people, it's part of the journey of developing a craft and developing skills and relationships with a filmmaker. And actually, Ben Wheatley is a brilliant example, because he made Down Terrace on such a low budget, but then it was a real calling card piece. And obviously, not everyone goes on the same trajectory, but
no, he's chosen his projects really very carefully afterwards. You know, they've been, you know, you look at Ben, you look at his brain. He Down Terrace cost literally nothing. It was in a set in a house, you know, a crime thriller set in a house, you know. What, you know, what's that about, you know, but he managed to sell that to a TV company, and then he's done the day he did a horror film, then he was asked, then he directed Sightseers, which was a comedy with a bigger company with big talk, and that had an advertising budget, and that's why he did well, part of the reason. And from there he sort of, he's now working, his bitch budgets have gradually gone up and up, you know.
He's a really good example of someone evolving, and all of those relationships and collaborations have been really important. So, for example, Dan Terrace, we did South by Southwest, and then Kill List also, because he has a relationship with the festival, obviously keen to screen it. That's sort of, because that was before, but then Film Forward put money into that, so he sort of then built his relationships with financiers and all of the crew that he has, these kind of long-term collaborators. So it's like a really sort of amazing journey and something very inspiring.
Yeah, that's right. Business is hard.
Anything to add to Christine?
No, I mean, I think it is hard to be an independent producer or filmmaker, but if you've got something to say or something to share, you should. And if the film route or visual route doesn't work, you know, if you're a writer, that's the beauty of it, you can write a novel and then maybe look at it later on as a film. So there's, you know, it needs, your creativity needs to come out somehow, if that's kind of an urge. But I would say if you're a filmmaker and you want to stay independent, then you do need another career that does pay, you know, your bread and butter. And if you're a producer but you want to kind of go and be paid, you do need to then apply for the bigger production companies and start at the bottom and grow within a production company. I never really wanted to do that, so I just wanted my own project. Therefore, you kind of have to juggle your day job and your film work, which at times is a bit challenging. It's or I guess unfeasible and not impossible.
Or I guess working across different media, doing TV commercials, and you know, all of the crafts sort of tie in. So, great. Does anyone have any questions? We've got have we got a very big mic going around? Yes.
Hello. I'm just wondering. Of course, there's multiple forms of ways in the industry. Obviously, you could do it through the sales reps. You could do it to potential television networks, to stuff like that. Going on DVD, Blu-ray, etc., video on demand. With regards to making any money out of it, it obviously, I've heard other people say it's you hardly make anything of anything, and such, and sometimes just lose money on it. Is an element of that potentially because the deals that are being struck are not good, and is there an element of, are the distributors actually making much money on that? Are they only just paying themselves? Are they making more money, or what's your engagement when you've spoken to these people? Because obviously, bigger studios, they obviously must make some money on distribution, but how come would an independent filmmaker have difficulty negotiating that? Is it they treat this worse, or is it the same? Any ideas?
The problem is the whole distribution system is fundamentally fucked, to be fair. Netflix has come along and sort of kiboshed everybody, and Amazon Prime as well. And, you know, it's tough. Home entertainment market is really struggling. DVD markets are struggling. Who buys DVDs now? You've got coasters. It's harder and harder, and it's hard. It's what's happened is the bottom has been squeezed, and then that sort of the middle. So, you know, we're doing a film now, we want to raise sort of 6 million, and people are saying that's even ridiculous. You want to get 10 million, because that's the sweet spot, or because then you can buy big cast, and you can build in worldwide sales already, and use that as part of your finance plan. So it's difficult across the board. It isn't that there's a big sort of, you know, the monopoly man sitting there in distribution counting all the money that he's exploiting independent film. It's not. It's just tough. It's just people aren't consuming content like that. You know, that's the trick, really.
You know, sales agent distributors, they need to cover their expenses. which is on top of everything else. They get a cut, we get a cut. But before you get that cut, all the expenses need to be covered. And you do want, you know, we did look, I mean, I've probably touched on all types of distribution, self-distribution, hybrid distribution, I've probably ticked most of the boxes on that, so I've had a little bit of a taste on everything. But when you kind of, you know, if you see the price of a DVD, you see the price of online, you do the maths of, you know, the expenses, they do need to go to the markets because that's where they meet the distributors. If you've got a sales agent, that's where their business is. Attending a market, Cannes, Berlin, LA, you know, is it flat, is it stand, is the posters, it's all the marketing, everything. That does cost money. So usually, kind of on average, an independent kind of sales agent distributor will have about 12 films or so, 15. Some of them will take a bigger slate, like the bigger ones. But it's not that many films, and they need to, every market, they need to launch a new title for the distributors to come and get. And so those deals are very slow to arrive. You know, not everyone wants to suddenly get their new film. So they have to kind of juggle, I mean, I'm not excusing any of the sales agent distributors, but I've kind of got to learn a little bit about how it works. And suddenly you realize it's not thousands and thousands of pounds that come back in. It's little deals of £2,000 here, another £1,000, you know, online or nothing there. If you've got an MG, it's brilliant. We didn't get any. So it's whatever the money comes in, and then you take everything out, and then there's a percentage, and then it goes into whatever else, you know, then it trickles back into the budget. But before it hits your investor or us as deferred fees or profits, that can take years, and it does.
And you send a collections agency to go in and sort of invoice or check the accounts of the distribution sales agency, so you can. You can see a breakdown of what they've sold and how much they've got, and it's, you know, as you say, it's what they spend on their P&A spend is kind of crucial. It's what they spend on printed advertising to get the film to market film for you.
I mean, we were talking to AFM, someone who was interested in coming on board Containment, and they were like, you know, I'll give you the rights back in a year if I haven't sold it. It's all minimum, you know, I don't have big stand, you know, I'm flexible, I'm agile and everything. And you kind of go, oh, well, that might be interesting. Except you go, not really, because once he's gone to his contacts, and I don't know how many he has, you know, the film has been over a year to probably a lot of people, and therefore it becomes old. So you kind of think it might be attractive, and you go, brilliant, I'm not locked in a 5 year or 7 years, because, you know, then I can get the rights back and do it myself or go to someone else. Except your film is then perceived as old and therefore harder to sell. However, you really want to make sure you sign with the right sales agent, and you really do need to do your due diligence and call a few filmmakers, you know, who have had their films released. Just so you're not kind of on the catalogue and they don't actually do anything with your film, because that's the danger, and I've heard it, and you know, filmmakers had wished they had been on in 1 year just to get the rights back and do it themselves, so you have to be careful.
I don't see that they are particularly, you know, making a lot of money out of us. I think, and likewise, not really putting much in terms of my experience of it, not been huge publicity or advertising or anything. It's just been that's what's happening, you know. But I don't know. Yeah, I tell you.
Yeah. I suppose it's quite complicated sort of landscape to negotiate, isn't it? Lots probably just really helps to ask other filmmakers about their experience. And everyone's experience is slightly different.
I mean, the deals the sales agent now are doing are kind of even changing, they're trying to get the best route to market by, you know, having hybrid sort of models. So I think everyone, you know, is trying to kind of get the best.
Metrodome have been very good to us, I have to say, but they're not all, you know, but they are like estate agents, and I mean that. So whatever your opinion of estate agents is, there's some good ones, there's some bad ones. That's what they're like. You know.
Do you find that sales agents and distributors aren't interested in a pitch if you haven't got a name attached? So I'm interested how you guys went about getting names attached to them.
Either you have a really high concept, a good hook, and that's what they're selling. So actually, ironically, Containment is, I mean, the poster is a hazmat. There's no cast on it, because even though Louise Brulee, and there's a few mini names, if you, you know, they're not known in the US, they're not known really, they're not that recognisable, so that was kind of sold on the hook. But if now with all my other projects, you know, the key thing is cast, which is kind of a bit annoying, because recently, in Evening Standard, someone wrote an article which kind of made me smile. It was like face fatigue, you know, because you keep going to the people who have so it actually doesn't really make sense. So that's kind of a bit, you know, frustrating, because you don't really always want to go with a recognisable name. Sometimes you've got an actor who's not that recognisable, but is a good actor, and that would be better for the film creatively.
Yeah.
And
sometimes it's bad.
What's the genre of your film?
Horror.
And they, at what point were you showing them the film? Before you made it, or?
No, yeah,
I
made it.
Okay, horror.
I'm surprised they're not saying that, well, okay, there's no names in it, but are you asking them for money up front?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm trying to get a sales agent in the early stages.
Just trying to get them excited about the, yeah, I mean, pre-sales is really difficult. That's not going to happen. I would say just get them excited and then try and have them sort of semi-factored into it. But if they don't buy the film, they're not supporting it, you know, they're not the right sales agent. And then I'd go show them the film, get them excited without names. You know, you've made films with no names that have done really well.
Yeah, that's right. Sightseeing's had no, you know, no one claims in it at all. But yeah, it's sold on the quality of the work, which is good, you know.
And a strong premise.
Strong premise, and the right people behind it, to be honest. I mean, you know, from a horror and a big production company like Big Talk, you know, you're in a different world there to what most of us have been talking about here. But, yeah.
Thank you.
So,
I
just had a similar question, a bit of a follow up. I've had similar experiences with distributors, only they seem to be interested in the film and the project, but lose interest when they realize there's not yet a big broadcaster interested. So that's a bit of a catch-22. I'm going to a distributor to get a broadcaster or the television broadcaster, it's a film for television, interested. And then they tell me, oh, we'll only get on board once you've got a broadcaster interested. So how, do you have any tips or any advice on that?
When you say it's a film for television, which means
it's
TV
documentary,
drama?
Documentary for television.
Are you pitching it to TV channels?
I pitched it to TV channels and broadcasters when I was still in production and got a lot of interest and was told to come back when I have more. Went to Sheffield last year, talked to a couple of distributors there as well, got some interest, but once they heard we didn't have a definite yes from a broadcaster yet, there was no answer.
Have you got a pilot?
Have you shot any of it?
Yeah, it's all filmed and in post-production by now, and I've got trailer and everything. I'm getting interest, people are saying it's a great story, it looks cool, but then I never hear anything back, or the students are like, oh, once the broadcaster says yes, then we'll jump on board, but if I have the broadcaster on board, why do I need the distributor?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
It is kind of a vicious circle. I don't really know the TV world, only from what I've heard, but it is, are you going back to Sheffield?
I'm hoping to, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I would definitely go back to Sheffield.
As soon as the edit is finished, I'm hoping to submit it for Sheffield.
Yeah, I would say definitely go network and have you got a trailer now?
Yeah.
Is that launched online?
Yeah, I've had the trailer very soon after we stopped filming, and been in post-production for a while now. It's been 2 years, but
yeah. And is the trailer, have you tested the trailer in terms of people kind of like it or
yeah, we've gotten really good reactions from people. I've gotten actually really positive reactions from National Geographic, which was very good, but then I never got any answers, never heard anything back, and it was
I spent my life emailing three times, sending the same email three times to people. It is, you know, you have to do it in a very gentle way. There's an art in chasing I've developed.
Calm stalking.
It's, yes, it is. But, you know, it is also going, are you sure you got the email? You know, it is a very sort of like, why didn't you respond to me? What won't get you anywhere? I get chased because I it's just the number of emails. People get snowed under.
Phone calls. Yes.
Yeah, and then there's the magic call. Yeah, do call people and you'll get further that way. But the go to festival is the key, and just kind of cornering people in a very lovely way and just sort of offering coffees, and you know, it does work, but it is slow. It's a slow process. I think people get slowed down there. We get just too many emails. You can't address everything. And then you go in order of priority. And the next thing is the emails are like 4 days old. I've forgotten about it, you know, it all happens. So the chasing is something, you know, and it's not the next day, it's like a few days later, but it is, don't not email again after your first or second
What's
email.
The name
also,
of the
might country? Go to the junk in junk.
So, yeah, right.
At the moment, I'm going with the working title Into the Jungle, and not happy with it, doesn't really convey what I'm trying to say. And the other problem, which is why I haven't been doing much of the chasing up, is because it's completely self-funded, self-directed, self-produced,
yeah.
Self-presented and everything. I'm doing the edit by myself because it's literally a no-budget film. I took up a loan to go to Papua New Guinea and film it.
Wow.
And just kind of try and sell. It's very much a passion project. The people in the stories that are involved in it are very dear to my heart and very important to me. That's why I'm really hoping to get it out there.
So if we Google it, we can find it online, can't we?
You should be able to find it where I can give you cards and stuff.
But there's also other ways, you know. You're aiming, like, you know, for filmmakers, you aim cinema, obviously, always.
Mm-hmm.
Then for documentary or, you know, TV, you aim TV. It may be that you need to go outside of big broadcasters and just find where those kind of documentaries have an audience.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it is online, you know. Maybe it is the smaller sort of platforms. I mean, there's a million platforms, movie, all of that. It's not relevant possibly for that one. But check what's out there and then sort of maybe launch it on one as an exclusive, and then it can grow. If it gathers momentum, a broadcaster may well come back later on it. So, you know, you can look at reverse distribution. You can kind of shoot yourself in the foot, obviously, as well, but it is worth looking at that rather than just sitting on it waiting for someone to reply if they don't.
Brilliant, thank you so much. Did you say something before we finish?
My name is Mike Dick. I'm from the Writers, Producers, Directors branch of BEC2, who are actually organising today's event. And yeah, nice to see such a good audience today. Thank the panel, to thank Jude for the, I mean, a really thoughtful and, you know, great advice they're actually handing out there. I'm just interested to find out how many of you are actually non-members here. Can I just check, show of hands? Have you all received this little envelope? If you haven't, come and see me afterwards. Because actually in this envelope is an application form and a pen to actually come and join BEC2 and to actually help us fight for all the benefits that you can actually see behind us. Also, if you join today, you get 25% off. That works out at £7.50 a month, which is pretty good value for all the benefits of better paying working conditions, legal services, special events like this. Public liability insurance alone is worth its weight in gold. So come and join us today and help swell the numbers that are actually joining BEC2. If you join today, you also get entered into a prize draw for an iPad and also the possibility of getting a signed collection of Ken Loach movies. Ken's going to be with us this afternoon. Lots of things are going to be happening this afternoon, so it's going to be a really good session. It's also lunchtime, so I would go out, grab yourself some lunch. If you haven't got one of these, come and see me just now.
Just say thanks so much for coming, and thanks.